an incorrigible delinquent at times. Behave yourself, man!
Now it's late. Ken Livingstone late. Which means we unreservedly apologise for insulting your intelligence with tonight's show. But just like Ken, if you think we actually mean it, you're a bigger fool than you look. Now, what could be more French than defying terrorism by raising a glass of vin rouge? On Tuesday night, with the city still in shock, Parisians did just that, as they flocked to local restaurants in a uniquely Gallic display of defiance. It was all part of a social media campaign called Tout au Bistro. Everyone to the bar to show that the terrorists hadn't changed their way of life. So without much persuading, we did our bit and sent the BBC's John Pienaar down to London's oldest French restaurant, Mon Plaisir, in Covent Garden, for our very own little display of solidarity. This is his roundup of the political week.
OK, there are more ways of showing solidarity with our French neighbours than just having lunch. But hey, we're all Parisian now, and that means loving life. It means loving good food and wine. It means loving freedom. And just now, it also means we're defiant and just a bit afraid. Just one in six of us thinks bombing the fanatics in Syria will make us safer. That's according to one poll. Today, another says three out of four of us want to do it anyway. When the terrorists attacked that theatre and those restaurants, they changed everything. It's time for a bit of solidarity. Carrying on as normal is one way to show defiance, but it's not the only one. Cheers. David Cameron's wanted to strike at ISIL wherever they are for months, and since Paris, the mood's changed. France and the USA want Britain more involved. So does the Sun newspaper. Remember those opinion polls? 2 years ago, Cameron wanted to bomb in Syria, and MPs said no. This time, he is forcing the pace towards a vote that he clearly thinks he can win.
We face a direct and growing threat to our country, and we need to deal with it, not just in Iraq, but in Syria too. Mm-hmm. I've always said there's a strong case for us doing so. Our allies are asking us to do this, and the case for doing so has only grown stronger after the Paris attacks.
At the present time, the issue of the bombing of Syria does not seem to me to be the right way forward on this, and so I do not support it.
There's another reason David Cameron's looking more confident about things these days. Jeremy Corbyn can't. More and more Labour MPs are finding more and more reasons to say, I don't agree with Jeremy. When he told the BBC he didn't like the idea of shoot to kill against terrorists, what was he thinking of? It's up to the police anyway. One shadow cabinet minister told me it's as if Jeremy lives on another planet. Another publicly put it a bit more diplomatically. A bit more.
In those very difficult circumstances where there is an immediate threat to life. You are trying to stop more people being killed.
He should have said
that.
But
it is right
though,
within
he?
Our procedures to use lethal force in order to protect those who were carrying on the floor of that concert
hall. If he thought
and
that,
I think that,
why
that would
didn't
be
he
widely
say it?
Supported.
If he thought that, why didn't he say it?
Well, I can't answer for Jeremy.
See what I mean? Relations between Jeremy Corbyn and so many of his MPs have gone from uneasy truce to Cold War. They agree to disagree on just about everything, including nuclear defence. And when he appointed Ken Livingstone to help oversee defence policy, a lot of them just lost it. Then Ken Livingstone said one pro-Trident MP needed psychiatric help. Turned out he had a history of depression. You could see he'd have to say sorry in the end. He knew he was on the ropes.
Well, I've been in Parliament for 15 years, so I've no idea about his mental state. But it's completely unacceptable for a Labour MP to attack Jeremy Corbyn's appointments in this abusive way. I grew up in South London where someone was rude to you, rude back to him.
Well, Well, I'm a South Londoner, and we're not all rude, not even all Millwall fans, who like to sing No One Likes Us, We Don't Care. Wonder if they sing that in Jeremy Corbyn's office before he meets his MPs. Ah, Tarine de Compagne, s'il vous plaît.
Certainly, sir.
Merci. George Osborne's got one thing in common with Jeremy Corbyn, just one. They'd both quite like to be Prime Minister. Just now, more people will probably think George Osborne's got more of a chance, including him, as he plans strategy on just about everything, the economy, Europe, even ISIL.
ISIL are already using the internet for hideous propaganda purposes, for radicalization, for operational planning too. They have not so far been able to use it to kill people by attacking our infrastructure through cyber attack. They do not yet have that capability, but we know they want it.
So, more money for security, which sounds popular, but that also means more cuts, which means trouble. Osborne has to square colleagues like Theresa May, who also fancies being leader, by the way, and she won't take cuts to police budgets quietly. Oh, and the leader of the opposition's on the case too.
Will he be able to tell us whether or not this community policing and other police budgets are protected or not in next week's autumn statement?
As well as wanting resources, the police want the appropriate powers. And hasn't it come to something when the leader of Her Majesty's opposition thinks that the police, when confronted by a Kalashnikov-waving terrorist, isn't sure what the reaction should be?
Well, they can all slug it out next week. I've got some solidarity to share, which may be easier than getting MPs to stand shoulder to shoulder on where to bomb ISIL, and a lot easier than getting a peace plan together for Syria. If only I could remember the words to the Marseillaise.
And from Mon Plaisir Restaurant in Covent Garden to our own little bistro here in the heart of Westminster. I've been getting away.